So what is it with Dark Souls that pulls me into the game, pulls me into the narrative? Yes, absolutely. The boss fights, the mega boss fights, the interaction tactically of the characters, exploring the various tiles, unlocking that puzzle of movement. But it's also the items. It's about the souls. It's about the blacksmith cashing in those souls, randomly drawing item cards, and now making a decision what to play, what to employ, what to socket. How do we utilize this? Do I upgrade my attributes? Do I bank the souls and wait? There are a lot of tactical decisions. And on a side note, I know there are house rules in play where a lot of players have created a shop mechanic or a way to limit the random draws of the cards. I've played with that. I've explored that. I personally prefer the unknown and the tactica of adapting each playthrough to what you get. Sometimes it's really good. Most of the times it's interesting. Sometimes it's just the wrong draws and not very good stuff. And certainly as you incorporate the various expansions, that deck of item cards grows and grows and grows. But in this tactica, we're going to explore the idea of armor, we're going to explore the idea of weapons, and we're going to explore the idea of understanding the dice mechanics. Underneath the game, the DNA of the game is driven by dice mechanics. And what we want to try and do, and this is true of any dice-based game, but Dark Souls is a little bit different. It needs a little bit of a tweak as opposed to a straight up dice based game. But what we see in any dice based game is this idea of random. We want to try and minimize the random. We want to try and control the random. We want to try and get the best possible output possible. In Dark Souls, we see this with the classification of the dice, the black dice, the blue dice, the orange dice. They scale up in terms of hits. They scale up in terms of value. Magic items, certain select items, certain weapons are going to allow you to roll more dice, more powerful dice. That's a way that we can influence the random. At the higher levels where you're rolling greater value dice, yeah, you could have a bad roll and not roll that great, but you're not rolling a fistful of blanks. So even when you roll poorly, the output is still pretty significant. There's a further layer, and absolutely no spoilers here, depends on what you're facing in the moment, the idea of physical damage versus magical damage. Some of the monsters, some of the encounters, some of the bosses are more vulnerable to magic, so even though the output might be a little bit less, it bypasses armor. And then, of course, moving into the evade. So we want to have a way in building a dice pool of dice that we're going to roll, either attacking or blocking, to be able to have the best value as possible. And then, of course, depending on the character that you're playing, the ability to reroll or stack dice or change dice. So that's certainly not unique to Dark Souls. A lot of dice-based games use it, whether it's a simple D6 system or a custom system like Dark Souls, or another example of a custom system would be Conan the board game. But in terms of survival, what gives us the biggest advantage? When you're staring at a pile of souls and you're staring at a pile of cards and you're kind of wondering, okay, what should I purchase? How should I build out my character given what you have? What's the tactica? What's the consideration? And this is where things get tweaked a little bit for the DNA, for the mechanics of Dark Souls. So often what we see in other skirmish games, and I'm going to kind of reduce Dark Souls down to a skirmish-based miniatures game controlled by AI, the enemy opponents, the monsters, the minions, the boss, whatever we want to call it, first has to hit you. In other game mechanics, it first has to hit you. And then after it hits you, it's going to deal some damage. And then with that damage, usually you get some sort of armor save, ability save, negation save. And then finally what's left over spills to life. And then you reduce that, maybe it's armor points, you reduce that from your life. Dark Souls accelerates that. This is why things are really, really deadly in the game. If you look at the monsters, if you look at the bosses, they automatically hit. They fulfill their AI, whether they move back, whether they move forward, who do they attack, aggro, threat. They do have a path, a decision path, obstacles in the way, other aspects. But when they attack, they hit and they cause damage. So what we see compared to other skirmish games or tactical games out there, there is no to-hit roll. They cause damage. So right away, that first possibility to escape unharmed, you are automatically hit. Now you have to make an armor roll. So this armor roll, again, yes, we're going to influence the dice and try to stack it with higher dice. But this is why, in terms of items, what I always look for, and it's hard. It's hard because you're tempted with some good gear to kind of level up on the attack with weapons and other abilities. Armor is number one. Stacking the armor as best that you can, as quickly as you can, because you're always going to be hit. So what that means is your armor roll, your defensive roll, and also evade could be a possibility for doing thief or assassin, or for some reason, if you're going to go for an evade type build, maybe you've got some items, maybe you just want to try it out, an evade sorcerer. Looking at it from that perspective, armor is key. This is further compounded in that your stamina and your life share the same bar. When they connect, you die. When they connect, you die. Now, you could heal up. That's going to use it for a spark. That's going to clear it. You do have the ability to regain a little bit of stamina every single turn. There are some items. But at the same time, as those two things go down, it's also going up based on hits and based on exertion, based on wanting to get the heck out of there. You get your free move, but then you want to move more and you want to get out of there. In exploring all of those aspects, again, it goes back to armor. That is the number one focus of the souls. And again, depending on what you draw. Now, weapons are a little bit different because we need to, and I can't give specific examples with this because a lot does depend on the draw. Maybe what we'll do, I'll make a note here, is we will just draw some random items and see what we get. Although I don't want to give away any spoilers with that because part of the game is so much in the discovery. But with weapons, we need to look and say, what's the mini boss we're fighting? Let's look at that. What's the mini boss that we're fighting? We have low soul, one soul encounters, two soul, medium encounters, three soul, heavy encounters. If you are facing the easier encounters, you know, if it's like three and one, three easy, one medium, then the leveling up of weapons is not as important because your characters can handle things a little bit easier. If you're facing a mini boss and they're at different tiers, different ability to get there. If you're facing one that's a little more potent, then the weapons become a little bit more important. We also have to look, are you playing to the mega boss? Now, in the rules, the idea is you fight a mini boss and then a main boss and then optionally tack on a mega boss. And admittedly, that's how I usually play the game. But playing it with friends, sometimes for time constraints, we are only going to play unto the mini boss. You need to kind of map out the possibility of if I'm spending souls, because souls are a finite currency. You're going to get them from clearing the tiles based on the spark runs. You might, in theory, if you hit up some chests, they don't convert to souls, but they're going to give you some item draws. You might face an invader. That's going to be a tough fight. So there's ways to get more souls in the form of card draws and currency that you would normally spend for that. That's going to free up some souls for attributes. But it's a finite economy. So we need to kind of look the best that we can with what we're going to purchase. If we are looking at a longer run, you're going to draw three types of items, three types of weapons. Some that are very, very powerful all the way at the far end, you know, tier four of your attribute stat bar. That's long term. Like that's something that you work on that you're probably not going to equip or be able to equip if we're talking a full playthrough until the main boss. And at that point, the plans might change a little bit. Likewise, there'll be some earlier weapons that they're not bad, but do you spend the attributes to go into those weapons and they become limited as you move to the main boss? And maybe they don't because they're your primary attributes. If you look at the stat bars, each class kind of has a primary attribute. It costs the same amount of souls for the secondary attributes, but they're not going to level up as much. So to play, say, like a cleric powerful weapon or semi-powerful weapon, playing the warrior or the knight, you're going to spend more in souls, just barely be able to equip it. And then as you pick up a primary weapon for the knight or the warrior, if you're playing them, you're not going to have the development in the primary attributes. So I'm not saying don't do that, but sometimes there's some weapons that early on, they're pretty good. They're not bad, but they're going to take you in a way that maybe is not the most efficient way to spend. And then finally, socketing. This is what's interesting. There's kind of like a crafting mini game in Dark Souls, and we're going to get more into that. There are ways to plug in components and gems to upgrade your items. Once you socket those items, that's it. It's done. Now, again, there are house rules. The blacksmith, you can unsock it if you pay a soul, and you do things from that perspective. And I certainly understand house rules. I normally don't play with them simply because it's the way the game is designed, and I want that level of difficulty to get good. You have to look and make that decision. Do I socket a lower level item to give it a little bit of a boost to gain me a little bit further? Or, and this is what I usually do, especially in the mini-boss run where things are a little bit more controllable, I save the upgrades. I save the sockets. You know, I save the gems. I save the metals. And let's see what we can get, because things really accelerate massively once you start going for the main boss. And the mega bosses, that's a fight. You know, that's an adventure in itself to even push out and move in that direction. So tactical-wise, how can we control the random? How can we influence the random? And in terms of that pool of souls, my playthrough, my tactic and my philosophy is armor first, because I'm always going to take damage and I need to survive. And if I get killed, then I'm not getting good. And then I lose a spark and then I can't farm for the souls. Weapon second, and then seeing what we can do about sockets.